So, thank you. So after that good lunch and all that champagne, I believe we are all in good shape and can start the talk. KIT is a pretty huge research and academic organization in Germany, in southwest of Germany. We have about 9,000 employees and 20,000 students. And some background for my talk. Most of our compute cluster outages were in the past years actually caused by Luster. I believe this would probably be similar with other parallel file systems. And in fact, with the file systems we had before, they were also mainly responsible for the outages. And even recently, we had seen some pretty bad Luster versions. Most of the latest bugs were related to new client operating system versions and the quotas. And so in areas where changes were done, the quota implementation had changed, and for OS versions also some changes were needed. I have frequent discussions with users about I/O errors. Often, only small changes allow that these I/O errors are omitted. And then finally, we had seen silent data corruption caused by storage hardware on multiple systems. And in case you have a huge damage, you need to restart the complete file system. So this leads to the topics of the talk. I will first present our Luster systems and then talk about challenges in making Luster more reliable. You have to find stable Luster versions to find stable storage hardware. It's good to identify misbehaving applications. And you want to recover from disaster if something really wrong happens to bring your system back into production. And hopefully with as much of the data as possible. So the systems we have at KIT, what is probably special is that we have one common InfiniBand fabric, where everything, all HPC systems and all file systems are connected. I believe this is a pretty good solution if you have mid-range HPC systems. You should take care to select the appropriate InfiniBand routing mechanisms and cable connections, because you don't want that the packets you're sending inside a cluster from one node to another travels on switches outside the cluster. So some care needs to be taken, but overall, I believe this is a good solution. Of course, you have a single point of failure with the InfiniBand, but we never had a complete outage because InfiniBand completely failed. And this is an alternative to LNET routers. So some huge organizations are getting similar functionality, being able to mount the file systems on various clusters by using LNET routers. The systems we have, there are different kinds of users on the systems. For example, we have a cluster for KIT. We have a cluster where the money came from different departments, and depending on their money, they get a share on this cluster. Then something similar for the universities. The 9 universities in the state of Baden-Württemberg gave money to this cluster, and according to the money they gave, they get a share. And then there's a so-called Tier 2 cluster, where users can make proposals for projects, and there's a steering committee, and this steering committee decides which users are allowed to do computation on that. Also pretty important is we have home directories on Laster from the beginning, and users have the same home directory on all of these clusters. Some more details. We have a total of about 5 petabyte capacity, and nowadays, the systems were bought from HP or via Dell, and HP and Dell both partnered with DDN. So actually, the support comes from DDN for all systems right now, but we are not fixed to DDN, so we are open. And we had lots of different systems before, and many from HP, and also one from Transtech and Gulip. For finding stable Laster versions, of course, we started with Laster 1.4, and it was always sort of a challenge to find stable versions. I just want to go 2 years back. With 1.8, 4, and 1.8.7, we had a pretty stable solution, but we needed to upgrade because we needed support for /11 Service Pack 2 clients, and for that we needed to upgrade the clients, and for that reason also, since two clients do not work with Laster 1.8 servers, we had to upgrade the servers also. Then we upgraded the servers to 2.1. This was pretty stable. The problems came mainly from the clients with /11 Service Pack 2. At that time, only the version 2.3 was available, and it caused some trouble. And after we had upgraded the clients to a maintenance release which supports /11 Service Pack 2, we were stable again. But then, same problem happened again. We needed support for /11 Service Pack 3 for security and support reasons, and for Red Hat 6.5. And therefore, for that version, this is officially supported with Laster 2.5. So we needed to upgrade the clients to 2.5. And for that, since we knew that 2.5 has some known issues or at least testing issues that it's not cleanly tested with 2.1 servers, we had to upgrade the servers to version 2.4. With the 2.4.1 servers, it was running, but we had some problems. For example, the failover configuration was bad, and this caused a number of problems. This failover configuration had gone bad because of Laster bugs, which are shown at the end. And also, the announcement of Laster 2.4.3, a security alert came from Intel. And this is really a critical thing because users could get access to all files by just modifying ACLs. So we had to disable the ACLs for that. And the lucky thing was that users were not heavily relying on ACLs. And other option would have been to upgrade everything just at once, but that's also something we did not want to do. Another problem is that the user and group quota values were wrong. So I'll talk a little bit more about that later. With 2.5.1 clients, we also had some problems with Red Hat 6.5 because from time to time they were going into status evicted. And another problem is that they showed LBugs from time to time. So some applications died. The cluster was still somehow usable, but some applications died from time to time. Um, Now we migrated all the servers to 243, and the /11 ServiceMesh-3 clients are running with Lustre 243 with no problems. This is not officially supported, but it is a historical reasons why we did that, because on this cluster we also had to mount an old system which is now phased out and which has used 2.1 servers, and therefore for 2.5 was not an option. So that's a reason, and since it turned out it's running stable, we just left the system with this version running. And the Red Hat 5 cluster we upgraded to 2.5.2, which is now also stable. The only problem, main problem, which is remaining is the quota issues. Quotas are still forged. I'm not sure, but I believe it's not yet fixed in a current maintenance release. And the problem is that some OST objects on the LDiskFS might get a wrong UID or group ID. This does not happen all the time, but it happens, yeah, in a small percent of cases. And also, we are right now not yet happy with the way how that could be fixed, because going to each OST object and check if the UID group ID is looks good, and then going back to the MDS, yeah, it's complicated, and we need at least some scripts and so on. So I believe DDN or Intel should provide scripts to support that. So bottom line is, you should try to choose a stable maintenance release. However, how to find out if it's stable, it's not so easy. It's also probably a good idea to stay with all stable versions in case you don't have problems. So you think about, is there really a reason to upgrade? And there's a bad dependency. If you need to do operating system upgrades, you frequently needed to do a Lustre client version update, and since the client version was updated, you also needed to upgrade the servers. And releasing these dependencies would be good, so servers supporting more client versions, also if an operating system upgrade exists, maybe it's possible not to upgrade the client version. The next challenge is to find stable storage hardware. We had silent data corruption on Infotrend and on HP RAID systems. I already talked about this at the ALWS 11, but now we found more details. For the Infotrend systems, for example, they provided different data when you were reading the data twice without writes, of course, in between. You could just do a DD on the block device and read several gigabytes and do an MD5 sum on it, and then you got different data, different MD5 sums. And this happened once per year on one of 60 RAID systems, so yeah. We at least we got it 4 or 5 times, and at least confirmed that data written twice was wrong with 2 RAID systems. And we also should also mention we did this from the RAID systems were attached to 2 servers, so you could do it from both servers. So it was really the RAID system. On the MSA 2000, which are actually I believe Dot Hill systems. The generation 2 systems had a problem with cache mirroring. I believe that only this generation 2 is affected, but yeah, don't know clearly. I think it was a problem with the cache mirroring, and since after we were getting PCI Express link failure messages in the logs from the controllers, and these PCI Express links are used for cache mirroring, when we did a file system check, this sometimes showed corruption. So Concerning the storage hardware, some hardware features really improve the stability, and such features, for example, which reduce rebuild times, like declustered RAID or partial RAID rebuilds with bitmaps. We have seen, the reason why this is important is that we have seen triple disk failures multiple times. So why do triple disk failures happen so often? I believe that disk failures are not independent from each other. So for example, if you have one disk failure, the controller enters into a different mode, does disk scans and so on, and then he most likely sees, it's more likely that he sees additional problems. Then you have to take into account the environment, for example, if it's too hot, or if you have a power outage, disk failures are more likely, and also under load, disk failures are more likely. I've seen that multiple times on various systems. Then features which detect silent data corruption are very important, like doing T10 diff or so, which should check sums on the data. So high-end storage systems are most likely more stable since they have features like mentioned here. And during procurements, it's important to give stability features high rating. That's actually what we do, stability features during the procurements get most credits. In order to identify misbehaving applications, it's important to find a way to find out which file is causing an eviction or on which files an eviction happens. And with version 2, there might appear messages like this, and the important part is the file ID shown in bold here. And with this file ID and together with the file system name, which is shown in other last IRM messages around it, you can identify the file with the LFS fit to pass command. And then when you have the file, you can go back to the user, you know which user it is, it belongs to, and go back to the user and talk with him what he did. So frequently you can find a way to omit such situations. And by the way, evictions are normal, they are just timeouts according to logging conflicts. And for example, if you just do an append one character to the same file from any nodes, you get evictions. Unfortunately, not in all cases the file is reported. Sometimes only the root of the file system is reported, and also in some cases the file ID is not reported. So it would be good if Lustre could add more file IDs which are responsible for the problems. To check the performance and to check what users are doing is also pretty important from my point of view. There were good instructions in the talk of Daniel Kopras at LED, given at LED 2012. For example, you can find out that users are doing using the home directories and writing Scratch to it, which should not be done, especially in our environment. They usually have a Scratch Lustre file system where they should write Scratch data, or they have local disks where they should write data. And and also, it turns out that frequently users do not know what they are doing, how their I/O ends up on Lustre. And if you look at it from the administrator's point of view and see, they are putting a high load on it, and then discussing with the users and discussing how they could improve things, really helps. This also helps because if you reduce the load on the system, this also stabilizes the file system. And of course, it also makes it more responsive. So, but getting rid of bad applications really helps to make your system more stable. Going to the disaster recovery, a disaster can be caused, for example, if you have hardware failures like triple disk failures on RAID 6. In case you have this, you lose an OST and all the data of that OST is distributed over the whole file system, so that's really bad. Of course, silent data corruptions are very bad too. They can be caused by hardware, firmware, software, by various components on the stack. Or you can have a complete infrastructure loss. And of course, if the first idea would be probably to have a backup and do a restore. But the problem is that a timely restore of hundreds of terabytes does not work. It does not work within few days or so, or within one day. So the reason is that the transfers just take too long. They are also frequently lower than expected. And then there are bottlenecks in the network, in the backup system. Also, if you have file systems with hundreds, millions files of files, the metadata recreation rates can become a limiting factor. And for example, we restored a 70 terabyte loss of file system with 60 million files within 3 weeks with old hardware. Yeah, we had expected it takes 2 weeks, but then also there were some IBM TSM bugs and so on, so it always takes longer than you expect. So anyway, this was not too bad, but still we thought, okay, next time we have 400, 500 terabyte system, we cannot allow the systems to be down for such a long time. Looking how other huge storage systems are doing it, the main idea is that they do not restore. They just create a copy and switch the client or the application to the backup copy. So if you have a client or application which has data, you usually create a snapshot. Then you transfer the snapshot to the backup system. After some time, you create an incremental snapshot, and transfer that incremental snapshot to the backup system. Then eventually the incremental snapshot is installed on the backup, and you can create new snapshots. By the way, these figures here are wrong. It should be numbers, but yeah, okay. That's probably some incompatibility. For disaster recovery, if something is wrong, you have to check your last incremental snapshot, and if it already was wrong, you have to remove it from the backup data, and then you redirect the application to the backup system. Since this mechanism is an asynchronous copy, of course, the data which was created after the last good incremental snapshot is lost. So you lose some data, but you are still sort of rolled back to a version which was known to be good. So if you transfer this to Laster, we recognize that there's a tool called rsnapshot, and this tool is just some Perl scripts which use rsync to create the copies, and it holds multiple copies just by using hardlinks. So for the unchanged data, it just creates hardlinks in the directories. So pretty easy and straightforward solution using standard Linux tools. So for the backup, you just do an rsync on the backup file system. Then for the incremental backup, you use rsnapshot with rthink and hardlinks to transfer the new data. And rsnapshot also removes some very old copies of the data, which are mainly hardlinks. If something fails, completely fails, you have to find out which rsnapshot copy is good. And then you move the directories to the desired location. And finally, you adapt the mount configuration and you create some links so that the path which is seen by the client is the same for the backup system as it was before for the primary file system. So since the path that does not change, applications can run as before. And then usually a reboot is also required since the primary file system might still hang. And of course, same as before, the data after the last rsync is lost. So with this solution, some details and experiences. We have three file systems with permanent data. So we are, mainly for the backup reasons, there is separation for the users between scratch data. They have to do a separation. Scratch data hold on one cluster file system where they have higher throughput and so on, but no backup. And the permanent data is hold on other file systems. So the users have to select which file systems to use. So that's one way to reduce the data which needs to go into the backup. And and with our snapshot configuration, each of the file systems holds production data and holds backup data for some user groups. And with that, this is sort of an active configuration, so active data goes to each of the file systems, so the load is distributed. Some experiences with did not yet need the disaster recovery on the production systems. Of course, we tested it, and we also did some restores of user data because restores are just a copy. This can only be done by the administrator at our side, but it's easier very easy to get the data back. The backup is done twice per week, and we just use one client and four parallel processes, and for example, for 100 million files and with 5 terabyte snapshot data, incremental backup data. This took 26 hours. We also still use IBM TSM for the backup. This was a traditional solution we had before. We did not get rid of it, and it's known to be safe and so on, and it allows users to restore data by themselves. But you could also allow with rsnapshot users to copy their data by themselves back. You would have to do a read-only NFS export. You don't want the users to be able to write to the backup copy. That's why you needed to make it read-only and via NFS. So some restrictions. In case you have a slow silent data corruption, this might pollute all your backup data. The same problem exists for other backup solutions, by the way, but we actually did not see this case, what means that in case we had a silent data corruption, the OSS were going into status read-only pretty fast. So pretty fast means within hours, not within weeks. Then the recovery does not work if the problem is a critical Luster server bug or a critical Luster bug. So if you switch over to the backup system and the critical bug is omitting that you can use the file system, then this also does not work. So maybe a solution for this is, or it might help if you have different Lustre versions on the primary and backup file systems. And then something we want to do is to investigate if we could replace the rsync in rsnapshot by Lustre rsync. This would omit the complete file system scans. That's still something which has to be investigated. So just to finish, this is the link to our snapshot, some more of my talks, and you can contact me directly via email if you want. Thank you.